There's only 1 week left until Washington plays host to President Obama's second term inauguration. The preparations on the west front of the Capitol building are well underway, getting set for the president, hundreds of distinguished guests, and a huge crowd. Celebrities will star at a series of special events, despite the fact that only about half of the 1.8 million visitors who showed up for the historic first inaugural 4 years ago are expected. Still, the president's private fundraising goal for the festivities is about the same as 2009. Then he raised $53 million from individual donations alone that were capped at $50,000 each. This year, the Presidential Inaugural Committee plans to accept unlimited contributions from both individuals and corporations. The committee aims to raise $50 million. In comparison, the second inauguration of George W. Bush raised over $42 million and took corporate donations of up to $250,000. Late today, we asked Steve Kerrigan, the head of the inaugural committee, about criticism of how this event is being paid for this year.
We are funding this event the same way as many civic events all around the country are funded, which is with individual and institutional donors who want to participate and make sure that this event goes off well because they believe in this country and they believe in what the event represents. The way we're doing this inaugural, the way we're planning it, and the focus we keep, which is on giving them as much access to it as possible, really is the most important thing to us. So we sort of let all the other white noise go by the boards.
For more behind the scenes of the inauguration, we turn to two reporters, Matea Gold of the Los Angeles Times and Nedra Pickler of the Associated Press. Welcome to you both.
Thank you.
So, Matea, let me start with you. Why did the president decide to allow unlimited individual corporate donations this year when the last time, no corporate, and there were strict limits on the individual?
$50,000 individuals were capped. Well, at its heart, it was a very pragmatic decision. The committee needs to raise $50 million in a pretty short amount of time. The donor base was really burnt out and exhausted after a campaign in which Obama raised a record $1.1 billion. And I think they knew it was going to be a tough slog to raise as much as quickly. But there's no question this really has disheartened advocates of campaign finance reform who had hoped that Obama would use his second term to push for a lot more measures restricting the role of big money in politics, measures he did not push for in his first term.
So what's the reaction? First of all, how's the fundraising going?
Well, right now it looks like they still have a gap of less than $8 million to go. I think they probably have a little bit of a buffer that they can produce the event with less than $50 million. But they will likely hit that with a lot of hard work in the next few days.
Nedra, who are some of the people who are giving money in the corporations? What do we know so far about that?
They're keeping an updated list on the website, but there's very little information. We don't know who these people are, where they're from, or even where they work. They're only a list of names, not the amounts that they're giving. And there are some fun examples, like there's a Samuel Jackson listed, but is that Samuel L. Jackson the actor, or Sam Jackson in Akron, Ohio? We don't know. But there are some familiar names on there. Some of the president's top bundlers from his campaign who raised the most money for him are on there. Some people who have come into the White House for meetings. We've run at the AP that list of names that have donated against the list of names that have of people who've been allowed to come into the White House to lobby, and there are some repeats. And there are a handful of corporations. Not all of them have gotten exactly what they wanted out of the president. For instance, AT&T has donated, and they were turned away by this administration from their merger with T-Mobile. So there are a lot of donors, and it's growing all the time.
And we said it's unlimited, but I guess it's $1 million. There is $1 million limit, is that right, or is it known?
No, there's no limit to what anyone can donate. They're accepting any amount, but they are sending out solicitations asking for donations of up to $1 million. Now that would be unprecedented. There have never been anyone who's donated $1 million to an inaugural committee before.
Matea, what are folks getting in return for the money? What is there some kind of package that's put together?
Sure, there are packages, and they're graded accordingly to how much you give. Tickets to the inaugural balls are pretty much the hottest commodity. There's only two official inaugural balls that the president and the first lady will be attending, as opposed to 10 4 years ago. Reserve bleacher seats for the parade. There's going to be a whole host of events, inauguration weekend, a children's concert, special special receptions for top donors. And so there definitely is going to be access for big donors. And that's really the criticism from advocates of campaign finance reform, that these folks, especially the corporations, are giving big money because they want preferential treatment down the line in return.
But yet, as Nedra, as you're saying, they haven't necessarily gotten it in the past. So does this say they're hoping to get it in the future?
Who knows? That could be the case. They might want to make better friends with President Obama. One thing I should note, too, is we will know the full information on these donors 90 days after the inauguration. And the inaugural committee is going above what's required by the law in putting these names out at all. But it would be nice to have a little bit more information.
What do we know about how the money is spent? What is all the, if this inauguration is only drawing, what are they saying, 800,000 people, half of the number who came the last time. Why are they needing to raise almost as much money? What do we know about that?
Well, they're, you know, putting a production on the mall for 800,000 people is still no small feat. So there are the big Jumbotron screens. There's the parade itself, which is a big logistical production. There are these two inaugural balls. And a new addition this year is this National Day of Service they have on Saturday, in which they're holding events all over the country to really, and what is part of the spirit of what they're trying to make this inauguration about.
Asking people to do volunteer work in their communities.
That's no small cost, actually. It is something they did 4 years ago, but this time they're greatly expanding it. They actually have staff on the ground in every state to coordinate this. It's basically kind of a vehicle to take their extensive campaign staff and put them towards this effort. They have about 550 people that are working on this inaugural weekend. And also the balls themselves, that he cut the number of balls down from 10 to 2, but these are really extraordinary productions, these balls. One of them is expected to draw 35 to 40,000 people across the entire exhibit space of the Washington Convention Center. That was a space that 4 years ago had six balls in it.
So it's not just any old party.
Right. This is a big party.
That you'd be going to. I wonder, Mateo, what about, we just heard from Steve Kerrigan saying it's all about access and we're not really paying attention to the criticism, but are they troubled by the fact that, you know, this was the president who came into office saying he was going to do things differently?
Well, I mean, I think you just have to judge them on what they do. I mean, it's clear from our reporting that campaign finance reform is not going to be an immediate part of the president's agenda right now. So if this was something that was really troubling them, I think they probably would be taking action on that front. I mean, I think they knew they were going to get criticized for the reversal specifically on corporate donations. But in a lot of ways, you know, this president has had to compromise when it comes to money and politics on several different occasions. I mean, he endorsed a super PAC that advocated on his behalf in the election after criticizing such groups. And so I think this is another example like that.
Last question, Nedra. For anybody who's watching, who's trying to decide whether they should come to the inaugural or not, are there still tickets available? Is participation possible if somebody hasn't planned by now?
Absolutely. This is actually a great opportunity for someone who was scared away by the big crowds last time. They're expecting a million less people to turn out that day, not to mention that the weather forecast is to be about 20 degrees warmer than it was 4 years ago. So there's open space on the mall. Anything past 3rd Street down the National Mall, you can come without a ticket.
And those of us who live here, we love the traffic and the additional visitors, don't we? Nedra Pickler, Mateo Gold, thank you.
Our pleasure.
Very much.
Thank you.
You can follow Inauguration Day on our website. We'll live stream all the main events, plus host a live blog filled with the sights and sounds from the Capitol.